Okay, hello friends. So we tried starting this from Marriage Broker Auntie's account, Priyanka's account, but there were some technical glitches, so we're trying it from here now. So I'm just gonna wait for her to join and then add her. Sorry about the delay. Man, is this pimplish ever gonna go? Just look at it, it's throbbing. Then again, I keep picking it, so I probably shouldn't touch it. Hello friends who are joining. I'm just waiting for Priyanka, whose account is Marriage Broker Auntie, to join so I can add her. Yeah, she has joined. Angry doctor, please don't start with your hospital stories. That's it. Those are like for another time. Okay.
I am waiting for Priyanka to join.
Oh, okay. I can see you. Yay. Okay, cool.
Finally.
I know.
That was so weird that you couldn't see me, dude. That's like never happened.
I know, it felt like a fizzle. I was like waiting for this moment like the entire week and
I am not
so I couldn't get it up.
As he would say.
Okay. Cool, awesome.
We are on my account. I will have you give an introduction. So Marriage Broker Auntie, what is your real name and what do you do?
Okay, cool. I am Priyanka Bharadwaj. I am based in Bangalore. I am a matrimonial advisor. I think that's an apt title. I mostly help people figure out who they should marry, when they should they marry or not, help answer all these questions and also stay with people, kind of like a friend to go through the journey.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how is that different from like the traditional Seema auntie.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't work with parents. I work directly with people who are looking to get married. And I mostly avoid the types that want to marry within their own subcaste or marry someone of a particular star and stuff. So I'm not very traditional in my approach, but I also don't really matchmake actively. That's not my main sell at all. I mostly just mentor people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you don't have like the bio data that you're going through like an Excel spreadsheet to like mix and match people?
Where my husband's giving me tea and like we're going through the register? No.
All the illusions are being shattered. So how do you find people for your clients to marry then?
So my belief is that there are plenty of opportunities to meet people nowadays, although not really right now, but then, you know, there are tons of apps and like, you know, websites, etc. So I feel like a lot of people have decision fatigue nowadays. They don't really know who to pick from the infinite choices that they have. So I basically work with people to try and help them figure out who they should end up with. Like, one of the things that I help people with a lot is trying to figure out, given who they are, what kind of a partner should they choose. Yeah, it's a lot of like deep work, like working on yourself and not really anything to do with the other person.
What are some of the most like common frustrations that people come to you with?
I think one of the questions that people have very often is, am I being picky? Because, you know, they've spent a long time trying to like be on apps, you know, their parents have tried to set them up, etc. But I think they have this constant nagging doubt if they're actually being picky, if they should just settle or like what is wrong with them, right? Because
I'm triggered.
Sorry. So I don't know if this is useful. This is something you should go back home and try. And I've tried it with like lots of people. Although a lot of people think this is very, it's a very simplistic approach. I have a good way to actually help people figure out if they're being picky, right? I have this little like 5-minute activity that people can try. And maybe you should try it too after this. So most people look for only like 4 things in a partner. That's just looks, smartness, niceness, and confidence, right? And everything is, you know,
so generic now.
on an average, you could have your own sort of like very niche preferences, but then somehow you can sort of put them under these 4 broad categories, right? So I usually ask people to rate themselves on all of these 4 categories on a scale of 3, below average and above average. Right?
Okay, those four criteria are smartness, appearance.
Appearance, smartness, niceness, and confidence.
Okay.
Now you can think of it however you want. Like looks could be body, face, like anything you want, but just, your idea of looks, right? So rate yourself on all these four categories on a scale of 1 to 3. So, let's say looks, you give yourself above average. So you get 3. Smartness, you give yourself, average, then that's 2. And niceness, you give yourself 1, then that's 3, 2, 1, plus something for confidence. I don't know, 2, right? So that's 8 out of a total 12. And so that's how you rate yourself. So I would say every time you meet somebody, give them a score and see if they're like better than you or worse than you. And if they're somewhere around you, that means you're playing within your league and you're not being very picky. But let's say you have a 6 and you're aiming for a 12, like maybe you're being picky.
Wait, how often do people honestly rate themselves as like less than perfect?
I don't know, right? Like, because I usually ask people to rate themselves. I don't ask them for the rating. I'll say rate it and figure it out. You don't have to come and tell me.
Okay.
Of course, you'll be honest, right? So, yeah. I mean, there's no one to judge. So, yeah. But yeah, that's one thing that people...
Sorry, I'm just putting like a pinned comment in there because people are joining asking like, what is this about? So I'm just putting chatting about matchmaking with Priyanka, who is a relationship
coach.
Advisor.
Coach. Yeah. Sounds fancy.
Okay. That's true. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so you don't actually go through their ratings on their own.
No, I don't. Right. I mean, it's an exercise that I get people to do on their own just to figure out, if they feel like they're being picky or not. I feel like doing this exercise gives you some confidence in terms of where you are, and you won't really like judge yourself too harshly for not liking somebody.
Yeah, that's true. I think
because it makes you feel bad. What do you mean?
I think I mentally do that, like rank people on these categories. Like,
true. I wanted to ask you this question, right? Like, how did you rate yourself as a software engineer, and how do you rate yourself now as an actress? Like, has anything changed in the way you sort of, any categories do you rate yourself differently? Or do you find that the rating of the other person is different now?
I think I definitely rate other people differently because I'm exposed to very different people. Maybe that's what it is. I don't know. Like, I think I find different things attractive now. Mm-hmm. But I think before I would probably give myself like, I would have given myself a 1 on appearance, a 3 on smartness.
I give myself a 2. Like, I'm not even a model.
3. This is software time. 3 on niceness and like 1 on confidence is what I would have given myself like in 2013, 2014. Now, since it is my profession, I will give myself 3 on appearance.
Good.
I will stick to my 3 on smartness.
Yeah, Georgia Tech computer science undergrad. Yeah, sure.
I stick to my 3 on nice. Actually, okay, can I just shamelessly give myself 3 on everything?
3 on everything. Oh, okay, cool.
I feel so conceited. Anyway, well, whatever.
It's 3 on everything. It's 3 on everything, right?
Because it doesn't count. I'm going to find another
one. Now we know why you're single, because there's no one with 13.
That's what I tell myself, honestly.
Yeah.
That's what I tell myself.
I mean, I always feel very surprised. Like, I've been sort of watching your videos for a while now. I don't even know when the first time your video sort of popped up on some timeline of mine, Facebook or wherever. For some reason, I thought you went to Besit and something like that. But yeah, I've been watching your videos for a while and I've always wondered, like, why are you single? Or like... why is it so hard for a pretty, smart, confident girl to find somebody?
I might end up crying on this session. No, I think the problem that I have faced... Ankit says you'll give me a max on niceness. Thanks, cutie. Harit says I'm lowballing. Who's lowballing whom? Okay, anyway. What I was going to say was that I think the types of people that I'm attracted to and who are attracted to me are extremely independent people, and so they are just nowhere close to wanting to settle down. So the people that I am attracted to and the people who like me are like super career oriented and super like, I have this many life goals to achieve and like I don't have the time to invest in relationships. So I think rather than having not having options, it's like not having options who want to like settle down, and like I don't know if I want to like full on settle down, stuff like that. So that's my self assessment in that category.
I'm reminded of your video about like the three types of boys: underwhelming, overwhelming, and whelming. So I'm guessing you see most of the overwhelming types, and where it's great to go on a date with them and then nothing ever happens.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a good problem to have.
It is. I will say I have like been on a lot of really good dates, but I haven't, like, relationship-wise, I haven't gotten to the point where I like see my future with somebody and all. Why is it so bad to be single?
It's not bad to be single at all. It was just a question.
Actually, on that note, how often do you have to tell someone like you are not ready for marriage? Like, just go live your life.
I do that sometimes. I mean, not very often, because most people come to me because they're looking for help to get married. So I try to address the particular issue they've come to me with. But then a lot of times when I see that people have spent like 10 years trying to look for somebody and they've done pretty much nothing else with their life, I ask people to like just enjoy, you know, their single life. I know a lot of people, like my own clients, who have said, you know, go and do your thing. You don't need to get married. Some people have done really cool things for themselves, which is great. And they're still single and they're so happy. And I actually send more clients their way saying, you know, get trained by that person and figure out how to be happy with your single life. Because there's nothing better than being happy with your single life. Like, I'm definitely not somebody who asks people to get married. Like, because some parents actually reach out to me and say, oh, listen, you know, I've been telling my daughter or like son to get married. It doesn't seem serious at all. Can you please talk to them? I'm like, no, I'm not going to tell them to get married. It's something they have to feel on their own. But, you know, if they want to get married, I'm ready to help them.
Right? God bless. May there be more people like you. One, telling the Akshay's moms of the world to please chill out.
Yeah, because I like to have some easy days at work too. I just want to help people who want to get married. Like, I don't...
Yeah. And how old are the people who come to you normally? Like, what age range do you see?
So, for marriage prokaryote, which is mainly for getting married, I get people anywhere between 26, 27. Recently... up till like much, much older, but like my typical sort of clientele is around 35 or 36, until 35 or 36. But okay. I've also like had people in their 50s reach out to me recently. And
that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's very cool. Except like, I feel like I don't have enough life experience to really sort of tell them about what to do with their lives. So I feel a little bit skeptical about taking them on board. Although they're very enthusiastic to work with me and they don't have any qualms, but I just... don't feel very equipped.
They've already figured out a lot of the things. It's just that they haven't met the right person.
Yeah, and especially like people who've been like married multiple times. I've been married only once, so I don't know what to say. With people who are divorced, like I have nothing about people who are getting married for the second time. It's just sometimes I feel like my advice might be too naive for them or too stupid. So I kind of, you know, prefer not to sort of work with people who are divorced, simply because I feel like I don't have enough life experience for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are a lot more divorces happening from what I'm seeing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And like the early 30s seem to be like a time when the dating seems to like refresh itself suddenly.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Like I once had a client who was 27 and divorced. And I was like, dude,
That's a lot.
But anyway, he's married again now, so
good for that.
Yeah, I know. In fact, he got married like much quicker than most of my like single clients who had been married even once. So maybe it's easier in that market.
Maybe actually, because they're very clear on what they want. Like my psychiatrist told me this, because I've had multiple breakdowns with my psychiatrist saying I couldn't tell him what is wrong with me. So he actually told me that like statistics, like based in the US, like research in the US shows that people's third marriages are the most successful. Because finally, by the time you're in your late 40s, early 50s, you actually know what you want and like what you're willing to put up with and what you're not willing to put up with. And so people who get married in like the late 40s have super successful marriages.
Interesting. This reminds me This reminds me of something that a woman once told me on the on a tube. I was going to work and I was carrying my little daughter and she was wailing and I was like really frustrated because it was really hot in the train. And the lady was like, "Oh, is this your first one?" And I said, "Yeah, it is." She's like, "Don't worry, it'll get better by the third." And I was like, "Woman, what makes you think I'm going to have a third one? Like, I'm dying here."
I have this conversation with my mom all the time about how the first one is like parents are just panicking. And by the second child, they're like, just try not to die. Go live.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh my God. Okay. I feel like there are some questions and like yes. Someone's like getting very worked up.
Why is it bad to date with marriage in mind to look for a partner on your own? It's not bad.
Yeah, it's not bad. In fact, I have a course called Arrange Your Own Marriage on YouTube, which is free. Go check it out.
Yeah. Next question from Bala Murli. Isn't it something like the people who those are getting into the institution of marriage as grown-ups? They are the ones who ought to make all sorts of decisions whether to go for him or her or not. So you're saying like the parents or people who are already successfully married, like they should be the ones making the decision? Is that the question?
I'm not really sure. I don't think I understand the question.
Yeah. So Bala Murli, if you could just clarify exactly what you're trying to say, that will help us. Why is this matchmaking series making its way into our progressive mindsets and flip of our lives now? It's not about progressive or not. Like, arranged marriage has been happening. Like, some of the most
well-traveled,
amazing people have gone through the arranged marriage process and are very happy. So, like, there's nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, if you choose to look at it as like an arranged dating, you know, setting up, meeting people kind of thing, then it's not, no one's like holding a gun to your head and saying, meet me at the mandap, like, today is the day.
Unless it's Akshay's mom.
What's the most unreasonable request you've got?
You know, here's the thing, right? I feel like every time you hear a request for the first time, it seems crazy and you're like, oh, what? Like, come on now. But I feel like the more I get to hear such requests, nothing seems unreasonable, really. Everyone is sort of justified in wanting what they want. I don't feel like people are crazy. Although I must tell you at this point, like what I find crazy sometimes... sometimes, you know, parents like call me about like their sons or daughters and they say, oh, you know, she's like this, she's like that. Like they give me like all details about this person. And like just listening to that, you'll be like, okay, it's not going to be so easy to find your partner. And then like an icing on the cake, they'll be like, oh, but we don't want this star or we don't want this gotra or like something like that. And he's like, come on, it's already so difficult. Like you really have to make it more complicated by adding that, you know, artificial sort of constraint. That is something that I find kind of silly sometimes.
Yeah.
But then again, that's because I don't believe in horoscopes except to like make myself feel better sometimes. But
Yeah, same. I mean, like that way, I have to give credit to Seema auntie also. She was kind of like, it's okay if the stars don't align also. It's like, if your horoscope don't match, then it's fine. Like, you can still go.
Yeah, I feel like she was using all that face reader and horoscope and all just for her own validation, I think. Because I didn't see any of the parents saying anything about horoscopes, right?
Yeah. No one. None of them did. Or at least we didn't see.
Yeah. True.
Again, I'm going to take a question. Why is arranged marriage looked down upon in the West? Because the West thinks they know everything and they figured everything out. And one day they will... Do they have a reality TV show now called like Love at First Sight or some nonsense, which is like you don't get to see the person and you spend like 15 days with them and then they have to decide if they want to get married or not. So they think that they look down upon it and then they make reality TV shows about it. So I don't think they know what they want. That's my opinion. What is your opinion?
Yeah, I think if you don't know much about something, it's easy for you to sort of discern it. Like, because arranged marriages aren't a thing in the West. They feel like it's some crazy snake walking around in the in the city kind of situation.
And I also think there's an assumption that arranged marriage means you like don't meet them at all. Like you look at a photo and then the next day you're married, which it's not like that anymore.
Yeah,
at least in the urban.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I saw the producer of the Indian matchmaking show, Smriti Mundra, also sort of clarified that, saying, you know, a lot of people think that arranged marriages are forced marriages, which is not really the case, right? It's just a way of social discovery. That's it. Like, your parents facilitate or some auntie facilitates meeting people, which is not very different from Tinder facilitating meeting, right? Auntie versus algorithm. That's it. Like,
don't, that should be like the title of this, Instagram live when I'm doing it. Auntie versus algorithm. That is the t-shirt you need to make, dude. You need to sell some merch. Yes, auntie greater than algorithm.
Oh yeah, actually I remember that. Maybe I'll make it a tagline of like something.
Yeah. There's one interesting question here that says, is it true that most women find it difficult to figure out what they're seeking as compared to men? What has your experience been?
No, not really. I think what I find is that, you know, related to men and women, and something related to this question, the answer to the question is no, I haven't seen that in my case. But what I found is most often men are very confused about whether they want to settle down or not. Like, for them, they're not confused about the woman, like which woman to pick. They're more confused about, hey, do I want to get married? Whereas women know they want to get married. They just don't know which man to pick. Like, you might be really sure about somebody and you might be like really serious, and you might see that the other guy is unsure. You might be freaky out thinking, oh my God, I'm so sure about him, but he's not sure about me. But he's not really not sure about you, but he's not sure about the whole marriage thing. So I've seen that a lot. Yeah.
Are there any other like gender differences that you've noticed?
A lot of times I see that men are more chill in terms of what they're looking for in a woman. I even wrote about this. I said, like, although women have sort of, you know, like progressed a lot in life and they want lots of different things from men, men's preferences hasn't changed a lot. They still want a good looking woman who's nice, who like keep them happy at home sort of thing. You know, all the career and education and all of that is just a nice bonus, like good to have. But I think more or less, men really just care about what they've cared about for ages. So, yeah, it's kind of sad, but yeah.
Oh, good question. What's your advice to such men, from Ankit?
What's your advice to such men?
Nothing. The men who have this.
I mean, nothing. What advice can I have? Like, do your thing.
Grow a personality.
Nothing that a single man can do to change this. I guess it's the whole generation that has to change, right? My theory could be totally wrong, but my theory is that men grow up seeing women like their mothers as some sort of role models in some sense. Like, you know, dad gives them a lot of shit, but women take it and they still put up with it. And men see that and they think that women are like that. Women, on the other hand, see their mothers taking shit and they think, oh my God, I don't want to have a life like that. That's crazy. I'm never going to end up with a partner like my dad or something like that. I feel like the day men start getting sick of their men, start getting sick of their mothers like that, saying, oh my God, why is she taking this shit? I want my partner to, you know, sort of fight back, be equal, etc. I feel like when you have too many men like that, I feel like things will start changing. I see some men like that, which is great, right? But they struggle a lot because women don't appreciate that. Women are like, what? No, I want a man who doesn't want to sit at home. I want him to go to work. I don't want you to support like my family and shit like that. Just go to work, be better than me, because that, like, my dad is better than my mom.
Oh my God. So many things need to be changed. Yeah. But like, on the perspective of the men, I think that is slowly starting to change. Like, some of the younger like men and boys that I've interacted with through like work and all of that, they seem to be more open-minded. Like, I think they seem to be more open-minded to this idea of like actual equality and like your wife being your partner rather than being like the one who stays at home and puts up with my shit. So yeah. I think slowly it's changing.
Yeah. Hopefully women also can change with that, right? It's not just men.
Yeah.
Like, while men are open to this, women also have to become open to looking for other things from men, apart from men doing better than women in everything. Like, you're doing so well financially, you know, professionally. Why is that not enough? Why do you need a man? Like, because I had somebody who said, I want a partner who can guide me because my father guides my mother every day. I'm like, why? You're doing so well for yourself. Why do you need someone to guide you?
I have to say, I have been guilty of this, of like wanting somebody who is more than me, until I finally, like, what, 3 years ago, dated somebody who was younger than me. And like, that equality, like, it still works, dude. Like, why should he be the one who is, you know, older than me and has his career figured out and like whatever, when I could be that person? Like, in that relationship, I was that person, and I guided him for whatever.
I think the only sort of worry that people have is women feel like if they end up with men who are better than them, who are like who they are better than, they feel like men are going to be insecure and there are going to be like lots of fights, et cetera, et cetera. And so they don't want to risk marrying somebody who's less than them in some sense, which is a legit sort of concern to have. But here's the thing, right? If you don't start changing it, and if 10 or 100 or 1,000 people like you don't start changing how things are done, we're always going to be stuck in this cycle, right? It's too much of a risk. Your entire life is ruined if you're going to marry someone who's worse than you and you're just going to be fighting every day. People don't want to put their own lives on the fire of sorts to change how things are for the whole world.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There are a couple of questions here, actually. Neha asks, with our parents' threshold, the age to get married is 22-ish. What is it with this generation? 35, yo. That's my assessment.
I just told you, like, before we got on this live, I saw a video where your mom said she'll be happy when she's 30.
That is a few months away. So unless someone in this live chat wants to propose to me ASAP, that's not going to happen.
What's the cheesiest proposal you've ever had?
I've never been like proposed for like marriage. Like, no one has ever approached me marriage.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess there was one guy I dated who was very like, "You are everything I want. Let's do this." And it was very extra because it was we had only been dating for like 2.5 months at the time, and he was like, "You are everything." Wow. Are you sure? I think maybe I was everything he wanted, but like, he was not everything I wanted, so that did not necessarily work out. But to
it
answer
really freaks people out. Yeah.
What is that age that you're seeing right now, the age benchmark?
One of the other things that I do is I also sort of assist people in getting married, which means I represent them on platforms. So based on what I've seen on all of these shadi.coms and Bharat Matrimonies of the world, women average age is around 28-29 and men is around 31-32.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the not average, more like the like mode age.
Okay.
Yeah.
Kavya asks, do you feel like there's a panic about turning 30, especially for women in India?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I have a lot of people who are around 30 always. So I'm running this little experiment called Dinner Club, where I set people up on virtual blind dates. So they just sign up with a little selfie video of themselves telling me who they are, et cetera, and why they're on Dinner Club. Interestingly, the majority of people that I have are, like, among women, are women in 30s. And you can really see they're nervous. They're nervous about being there. They just simply cannot date casually. Like, no matter how much they tell themselves, like, they just want to come out of every date having met the person. And like, there's this whole efficiency, like, bug in you that's like, oh my God, just show me people. Like, you know, like Aparna, right? Like, she doesn't have time to go on dates with people who are not her type, right? It's like that. So yeah, it does affect matchmaking, because you make people nervous. Whoever you meet, even though they might like you as a person, it makes people nervous because you have this urgent energy about you. Like,
this is just being aggro. Like, so how many kids do you want? Oh my God.
Yeah.
There's more questions. This is really interesting. What's your opinion on live-in relationships? I'm for it, as it's better than marrying and then getting divorced. At least the social stigma attached to being a divorce, they won't be there. I am all for a live-in.
Yeah. I mean, whatever works for you, right? Like, anything works.
It depends on the person, I guess.
Marriage is just to lock some guy down and so that you can train him and, like, he won't run away easily. It's like
all the men have suddenly dropped off this guy. Now that all the women are here.
This is like joining like TCS or Wipro, where like they make you sign a bond and like you can't leave before that because they're training you. And so I 4 years after I got married, I moved to Barcelona to do my MBA. And when I was leaving, my husband was obviously, you know, a little nervous. We were going to stay away 2 years and I was going to be in Barcelona with like a class full of really like sort of hot people. So he was like, oh yeah, I mean, you know, like, you know, some of my friends are saying that, you know, like you're gonna go out and have I was like, dude, listen, I've invested too much time in training you till this point. Like, believe me, I'm not training another man from scratch. I'm done.
Yeah, dude, that's like opportunity cost, man. Like, why do you want to start? You're in too deep.
So Murali says, I'm definitely not getting married after hearing this. Oh, the TCS bond thing. Yeah, okay.
I still think that people still can't accept that as a woman, I'm confused if I want to be married or not. What do you think about that? Sis, same.
Yeah, I mean, I'm married. I've been married for 10 years. I'm not even sure this is a good decision. So.
Oh my God. These are some really interesting things. Interestingly, you mentioned about a certain nervousness in women in their 30s. Your advice for them to casually date?
Ooh. Here's the thing, right? Like, I feel like it's important for you to feel desire for yourself constantly. Like, you need to sort of find yourself sexy throughout your life. As long as you do that, you don't need another person to complete you. Man, woman, nothing else. So you have to sort of practice that on a daily basis for your own good. And it doesn't matter whether you're getting married or not. I feel like when people see that vibe about you, where you're enough for yourself in a sort of positive, non-aggressive sort of, you know, dormant way, I feel like that makes you a bit more attractive. It calms you down. It calms the other person down. So I would actually say invest a lot of time on yourself to, you know, to try and make yourself sexy. I always say this, if taking a shower every day for an extra 10 minutes is going to give you time to think about yourself and feel awesome about yourself, do it. Because all of us need to feel sexy every single day. And I mean, whether you're married or not, that's something you should feel. And as long as you feel that, you're going to be casual with respect to dating.
My self-sexy move is like the post-shower, check myself out for some time.
Yeah, that's like, great.
Just like play some hip-hop, some like fergalicious, and just nice. Be like, so delicious.
Yeah,
it's something I learned to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's something I learned to do. It was like self-love was a long journey.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, initially you feel so weird, you know, like you feel so like, why am I telling myself I love myself? But now, like when I walk past Peter, I'm like, you got it, girl. And it just feels so nice.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, if that feels unnatural, right? Like for a lot of people, it's like they can't do that because they don't feel that about themselves. Like the way I get people to start on this whole journey of, you know, self-love is to start with self-awareness. Just watch your body, like watch your body so intently every day that you should be able to draw it without seeing. Do you know where every sort of like bump is, curve is, and like, you know, fat globules are and all of that? Like, that's when you become so self-aware that, you know, you'll start to sort of acknowledge yourself a bit more. Like, even if you don't say, hey, sexy, which, by the way, takes a long time to get to.
Yeah. There was one that said, can you save this live? Yes, this live will be available on my IGTV, and Priyanka, I will send it to you also.
Yeah,
I'll super. The MP4 and send it to you. For me, that would be working out and getting in shape. Yeah, I mean, that's working out always makes me feel a lot better about my body. Even if I'm not eating well, if I'm working out regularly, I'm just like, endorphins.
Yeah, I hope nobody from my gym is seeing, but I hate working out.
I mean, I hate working out until right after I've worked out. Like, as soon as I'm done working out, I'm like, I love it.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
Self-love is so difficult, especially when we are raised with the concept of someone else loving us. Oh my God, yes, queen.
Yeah.
Can you print that on a t-shirt?
Yeah.
DM me, girl. T-shirt, let's go.
Yeah, I mean, so much of our childhood is all about just, you know, being perceived as nice by others, doing stuff for others, which is really annoying. Like, I feel like the focus is never on us. Still, you're like 30 and you're like, shit, I'm 30 now. Like, you know, yeah, it's really hard when you're like single and you have to practice self-love, like totally understandable. But yeah, just start with self-awareness. I feel like that's a good place to start.
Yeah, I have some more questions for you. Are there like, so you've met so many people, right? Are there types that you come across? Like, you know, I was talking about like underwhelming, overwhelming, and overwhelming in my video.
Yeah.
And I've done an anti-pushing video with like five types of people. So what are your like categories of people that you come across? Like with men and women.
Yeah. So disclaimer, I'm only going to talk about the kind of people who come to me and not the entire world. Because I don't want to like generalize and all. I think the first category of people who come to me are people who I have like one or two conversations with, and that's it. Because these are people who are absolutely crazy obsessed about horoscopes and subcasts. Like not even castes, like subcasts. And then they like seem like they want to be liberal. And they'll be like, oh, even that subcast is okay. We're okay. We're quite liberal.
Wow. We're so open-minded. Tamra or Madhava Brahmin, either one is okay.
Oh, no. By the way, maybe it's sub-subcast. Maybe I got that wrong. So they're like, oh, we're Vadgalai, but even Tengala is okay for us. And I'll be like, yeah.
Like, so Ayur Iyengar is like India-Pakistan, like not happening.
Yeah. I mean, that's just another level, right? Yeah, so these are people who, parents who, you know, come because, you know, some relatives would have shared it, and Chinese whispers, they won't know what I'm doing. They'll come to me. So, yeah, that's definitely one type of people who come to me. And I actually wrote this down because I thought I'd forget. the other type of parents who I like, but you know, it's like an acquired taste. I have to like work with them to like them and stuff. They're the wannabe cool parents. They're like, oh no, we've raised our children very liberally, and you know, it's okay. And like, I'm happy to put my, you know, kid in touch with you and everything. They'll put me in touch with them, but they're like constantly sort of stay in touch with me to like keep tabs. Or their son or daughter itself will be like constantly updating them within like 30 seconds of me talking to them about
helicopter parents.
Yeah. So these are types of parents that I get, but the kids that I get, slightly like one level down, kids who will be like, my mom told me to contact you, here are my details. And like, I'll send, like, I'll ask them any other question or I'll say something. Radio silence. Like, I'll have to contact.
You get ghosted.
Well, I get ghosted so often, and it feels so bad. Like,
check out Auntie's video on how to handle ghosting.
I think I saw that. And the worst part about being ghosted is like, I'm left with their money, and I don't know what to do with it. Like, I know what to do with it, but like.
If you ever feel like you have too much guilt money, I can send you my bank details. Just send over. Consider it like supporting the heart.
Yeah,
so, it's weird to like get their money and not do anything.
They'll just ghost me and they'll go off. And like, I'll be like, okay, at least give me your bank account details. I'll send the money back. And like, nothing. Zero. Like, you don't.
That's how gyms make their money, dude. The initial sign-up splurge on Jan 1st and then Gaia.
Yeah. True. Yeah, maybe I should start a relationship gym.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that's the three like main categories. Yeah. Or you have more?
So people, no, I have a lot more.
Yeah,
I'm only going to talk about the parents because I usually work with people who are looking to get married, and I have nothing against them because I think most people who come to me are like, there's a lot of self-selection. They read everything that I've done. written, they go through my videos, etc. And so I feel like a lot of people who I finally speak to, like people who are looking to get married, are not crazy. I get lots of rich parents who are super duper duper controlling, like
just saying.
So where they'll be like, oh no, first we have to talk to the parents of the boy or the girl, we have to get along first, you know we have this background and that background, we have to approve of like the in-laws, like I don't know. Just what do you say?
Business acquisition or what?
Yeah, right. So they ask me like lots of questions about the boy, the girl, about like what they're doing and everything. And then they'll be like, yeah, we'll let you know, like HR, like, you know,
we'll let back you know. Yeah, we'll get back.
So I find that like, I mean, which is understandable because there's a lot of wealth at stake and all of that. But I also know some really cool, rich people who make these decisions on their own and parents aren't sort of hovering over them. But there's a section of people who are well off and don't sort of allow their kids to take decisions, which is kind of sad. It's kind of like Akshay's life a little bit. What else?
I mean, there are some questions also. So sorry to cut you off, but okay. We'll do like two more categories and then we'll do the questions.
Cool. Oh yeah, I'm getting questions. Yeah. Okay, I'll tell you one last actually. I like people who get in touch with me and, you know, don't really know anything about me and they just got my number from like somebody through WhatsApp or something. And they'll talk to me like I'm some SLC boss and like don't understand anything. And they'll be like, oh, my son is in America on the West Coast, okay, in San Francisco. And I'll be like, okay. See, he wants someone of H-1B itself. We don't want girls who will go there and be housewives because, you know, double income is important. I'll be like, okay.
But you can't talk with an H-1B spouse. These are also auntie. Get with the visa program.
So I'll be like, okay. You know how it is in America and all. They'll say like, they would have gone once, like, you know, to visit and they would have done like some Grand Canyon and like all of those places. So yeah, I really like those types because they talk to me like I'm like some really like their security guard or something. There's this whole like tone of condescence, like, you know.
Oh my god.
Yes.
Deep level, dude. Amazing. Yes. We'll come back to the categories if we have time.
Cool.
Wait, let me go through some of the questions. How, Sumedha is asking, how has the pandemic changed the matchmaking process? Do share ways to keep the process going when you're unable to meet someone. Dude, now is the best time to get on apps. Yeah. You can talk without any pressure.
To answer the question, I feel like a lot of people struggle even before the pandemic. This is something that I used to say for people who stay in different like cities or time zones or whatever. Just if you're serious about it, like set up a video call, and if you're comfortable talking to each other, do like regular video calls. And when I say regular, like maybe like once a week or once in 2 weeks or something, like nothing too often. But then, so it's a great way to connect.
Okay. What is the drink I am having? I am having a homemade wine, actually, made by my aunt. Madhuri asked, I have a question. If you have two or three options of people, who do you think you can match with someone? How do you choose who to go with? Good question.
Pick one and send the rest my way. No, I'm kidding. So I always say, start with yourself, right? You know yourself really, really well. Start with who you are. Make a list of like five little adjectives to describe yourself and say, for the type of person that you are, what kind of a relationship will be very comforting. And through a couple of conversations, you'll figure out if the person that you're talking to brings the same sort of values. And then, you know, if there's a value sort of match, then you know whom to pick. I feel like it'll be really easy. But thanks for the question, Mads.
Yes. What's the point of finding a match and then parents rejecting it? And then there is honor killing. Ajijo, honor killing and all is a bit outside the scope of this conversation.
Yeah, sorry.
The question is, how do you convince your parents once you found someone?
Dude, Nowadays, I have a lot of parents who always like say, hey, I thought he'll do love marriage, but he came back and he said we only should search for him. I actually have a funny anecdote. So I have a friend who, you know, had a bachelor's and was trying for master's and didn't work out, kept trying a few times, etc. And he turned 26. I think dad came, sat down with him in his room and he was like, okay, listen, you've written cat a few times. Nothing's happening. You're 26 now. Should we, you know, get you married? He was like, yeah, okay, cool. And dad is like, oh, okay.
What? If you have some...
Dad is like, okay, cool. I mean, if you have somebody, please tell us. We're fine. We're very liberal. We'll get you married to whoever. He's like, no, I don't have anyone. He's like, oh, so you want us to search? He's like, yeah. And dad's like, yeah, kappa, ning taaka tilva yarnu hudkolak.
Translation, don't you have the guts to find someone on your own or the strength to find someone on your own?
And this guy is like, I cannot believe my dad is actually pissed off that he had to find someone for me.
But this is happening with my friends also. Like the ones who find for arranged marriage are the ones who like, dude, I'm talking about like the most beautiful, accomplished, intelligent, smart, like everything, like all like beauty, brains, everything. Okay. The most interesting women I know have tried dating and they've just found like they've dated morons who were just like, because these girls are so beautiful and so accomplished, like they are like that, you know, like the moths around the flame. So they have a lot of options, but they're still moths. So finally, like, one of these girls got tired of it and she's like, I can't. And then finally, like her family found her somebody and she's like really happy now. So very glad for those women.
No, but you know what? I'll tell you what. A lot of women that I know who are single are like that. Extremely good looking, intelligent, very well accomplished, rich, sorted, like everything. Because the problem is men aren't keeping up. Like,
yeah.
So
what you should do is introduce all of these women to each other, / add me to them. And we will start a commune where we will just live and like raise some children like together as a... alternative family. That's the plan.
I'm sure Mads would love it. No, I meant you, not me.
How do you do?
Eeny, meeny, miny, mo.
Flip a coin.
No. So, actually, for me, my matching happens very, very intuition-based. And also, if I have three people for somebody, I'll try them one after the other to see which one works. If I feel really strongly about everybody... but usually it's like some epiphany that'll come to me. It'll be like, oh my God, they talk similarly. They have similar fake accents. They have like similar irritating voice. So I'll be like, you know, some thing like that, like hits you and you're like, okay, you know, I'm sure they'll get along and it'll turn out that they actually get along. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
There's one more question. I see that women asking for nuclear family is seen as a big taboo. Do you get those kinds of parents or single people?
Yeah, people who don't want to stay with their parents. So here's the thing. A lot of people like move out of their homes pretty young nowadays, or like, you know, a lot more women move out to study or work. So it's very natural for them to want to live independently and they can't really like adjust with their own parents, let alone someone else's parents. So I think there's nothing wrong in asking for that. But I know there are a lot of parents of boys feel like, oh yeah, like nowadays only such women come. Women are so demanding. And like, they do come, but like, you know, I obviously kind of go back to them and say, hey, come on, like, you know, it's okay. Like, yeah, they're all adults and they need to like live on their own. Yeah. So yeah, I do get people like that and I totally get it. And I also help people with figuring out how to figure out if, you know, if the boy actually wants to live on his own or wants to live with his parents very like tactically. I feel like I have a video. Maybe I'll add a link later.
Yeah. Man, those are questions like I haven't even gotten around to like thinking about or considering, because like none of my relationships have ever gotten that far. But now this is giving me all kinds of new things to think about while I'm mentally summing someone up. Okay, we actually have like 16. 10 minutes left. No, because we started.
Okay. Got it. Yeah. Okay.
So we'll just do a few more questions.
Wait, so Madhuri, did we answer your question? I think we did. The example where you gave parents of being liberal is a tiny minority, sad but true. On average, how many people do you have in your pool of people? So Sumedha, she answered the question earlier that she doesn't maintain the pool, right?
Yeah, I don't really have, like, I don't matchmake. That's not my, although, yeah, dinner club, the experiment, I have a few hundred people. And it's an experiment that was just there for 3 months. Started end of June, it'll end end of this month.
If you're starting another badge, let us know.
I'll let you know.
Okay, how to convince parents who are stubborn, liberal parents are a tiny majority and non-existent in tier two cities?
Oh, I feel like it has to be a whole course in adulting properly.
Yeah,
how to convince parents who are stubborn.
Yeah, and that applies, like those skills apply not only to parents, right? Like standing up for yourself is something that you have to learn to do in general, whether it's to your parents, to your partner, to your boss. So that's like a whole personality development course unto itself.
Where you could possibly meet someone interesting.
I know, right?
Because I know somebody who met their husband in a personality development course, so...
people are making the best of all opportunities, dude. I have found quite a few, not quite a few, that sounds like a lot, but like I have found more than one partner through some sort of gym / workout / something because they're shared.
When I was single, I would never miss an opportunity to, like, you know, make use of a new social situation.
I miss house parties. Nuclear family equals girls stealing your son away or you tearing you away from your parents. Yeah. Well,
yeah.
Good summary. Okay, we have like, 10 minutes left-ish.
I feel like there was one question that we missed. I have OCDs.
No.
Okay, I missed that. I feel like I saw that and I missed it. How to break the stigma of finding someone online in my head?
Yes.
I always feel like I want to meet someone in person. I mean, do you have a choice now?
True.
Yeah.
A pandemic is the best way to get over the stigma of meeting someone online. All that you have. So I don't know if Karishma is still there, but make it happen, Karishma. As she was saying earlier, just do the video calls. Make it work.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have 10 minutes left. Do you have any questions for me?
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so I actually...
So prepared, yes.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask you, how's dating been different as a software engineer and as an actor now? Like, what are the main differences?
I think
it's both are sort of illiquid. Like, undergrad, Georgia Tech... pretty and actress in Bangalore, well educated, is like you're like the Natalie Portman of Bangalore.
Oh my god. Let me recover. I think the main difference is that I am meeting very different people, and so with the software community, like the people that kind of have their whole lives planned out ahead of them, they are much more ready and willing to like get into very serious relationships and like seriously talk about marriage and taking things forward and stuff like that. But like with the artist community / being around a bunch of freelancers, all of us are kind of like, we have no idea what life is going to be like. And everyone lives a kind of like bohemian lifestyle where it could be that I'm moving to Bombay for 3 months and then I'm like, you know, just I'm going offline and going to Shimla for 6 months and then I come back. So there's no sort of stability in the, I think that people are thinking much more short term than they are long term. So I think in that sense, it's very different. I think I myself have changed like that because I don't know where my life is going to be. Right? I need to be, or I want to be ready to pick up and move if I have to. And so I will have to find someone who is either just as flexible or is willing to move with me or continue kind of like playing the casual dating scene for some more time. So that's where I'm at in terms of the differences.
So in like when you, I'm sure like since you've been an actor, you've been in sort of semi-serious relationships or like relationships that were a bit more than just casual. What were like the biggest challenges that you had or like what were the issues that the other side had? Obviously nothing too personal, but like something like generic for your personality?
I think insecurity was a big one, probably the biggest one, especially since I became an actor, because a lot of my friends are like just the most beautiful people. And they are just my friends. They are my colleagues. But that really gets in the way when you're dating somebody who's not in the industry, because they don't interact with those kinds of people. And so there's always this nagging thought of like, why is she even with me types. And the other thing that happens is that it's in their head, honestly, but they will say things like, people are looking at me. They're wondering how I got a girl like you. Like, you know, they know I'm not good enough for you. And I'm like, no one is saying anything, bro. Like, you are saying that. Like, there have been very few people who haven't felt this. And they have been like very good looking, very accomplished people. And they are like secure. But for the most part, it's like insecurity plays a big role. And I think there is a lot of like, the other thing that happens is like a mismatch of expectations, because I'm meeting these people organically, like through day-to-day life, right? So there have been times when they've wanted a serious relationship and I haven't, or I wanted something serious and they haven't. So I think those are the two biggest things that are happening.
Do you have a high bar for intelligence, like when you meet people now, and how easy is it to meet intelligent men, in the arts?
Intelligence is not hard to find, especially like in the theater community. There are a lot of people who are very, very well read and well traveled and well spoken and all of that. And like, they read a lot because they're performing, they're writing, they're creating. So intelligence is not hard to find in the artist community. The high bar, I would say, more than wanting someone who already knows everything, like I prefer people who are curious and like willing to learn. So, like, obviously none of us are born like knowing everything, right? Like, we're just curious people. And so if you're curious,
go ahead. I'll tell you once you finish.
Yeah, no, it's just like, if you're curious and you're willing to learn, like for me, if I see something randomly and I'm like, oh, what is this? Like, I have to Google it. I have to figure it out. I have to like know the answer. But it really like shocks me when people are like, oh, what is this? And then they're like, doesn't matter. I'm like, how can you let it go? So curiosity is more important than intelligence, I would say.
You know, sometimes when I listen to people, I feel like, oh my god, why weren't you just a lesbian? Like, would have been so much easier, because I know a girl right now who I can set you up with.
I wish she was
also a lesbian.
Oh damn it, Suzura. I am open to dating women.
Mads, you know who I'm talking about.
I am open to dating women, but unfortunately I'm straight, so sadness.
Yeah, I mean, I always keep thinking, right, like all the women that I meet are so great, so awesome, and you find that you don't find enough men like this. Although if there are any men like this and you guys know, you know, send me a DM later, we'll do another thing.
Okay, we have only 3 minutes left, so we can maybe do one more question.
Okay, last question.
There's nothing in here. Any more questions that you have for me?
Any more questions for you? Okay. So now that you have 6 months left, or like a few months left before you turn 30, is your clock ticking? Are you feeling nervous?
I think I felt more nervous when I was 26 than I do now.
Okay.
Like when I was 26, it suddenly felt like, oh, I'm closer to 30 than I am to 20. But now that I'm actually like almost 30 and I have so many friends who are like 35 and chilling and living their best lives and like still casually dating, I'm like, there is time. There is so much like hope. And the thing is, like, I have been lucky enough to meet some really interesting people through my work, through extracurricular, through whatever. So honestly, I'm just like enjoying meeting people. And if something works out, great. If it doesn't, like, my work is my jaan, my pehla pyaar, so I guess in a way, like, I have the love that I have been looking for, like, with my work. Like, that's, I would do nice. Anything for my work, and like, I feel so fulfilled from it, and like all of that.
That's so really cool. I feel like those vibes should actually help attract a really cool person. If you were on Indian Matchmaking, who would you have preferred going on a date with among the men there?
Honestly, none of them, dude. None of the boys. Like, I mean, I guess in terms of just purely out of familiarity, like I just know a lot of Pradyumans. Oh my God, it's a 30-second countdown has begun.
Oh,
I know a lot of Pradyumans, so maybe I would like be able to tolerate a Pradyuman the most easily.
And his
I
fox guess. Nuts.
Yeah, and his fox nuts, because I'm like all about Advait this year, my favorite topic. But 10 seconds left. My mother wants me to marry Advait. Advait is like, marriage is a non-starter, so... That's a different conversation for another day. 3 seconds remaining. Thank you.